Hi, I'm Marge Easley with the League of Women Voters. To help with your voting decisions for the primary election, we've invited candidates to talk with us about important issues. Welcome to our video voter's guide, and welcome to Gary Carlson, candidate for State Representative, District 28. Hi, Gary, nice to have you here.
Very nice to be here.
Could you tell the voters a little bit about yourself?
I'm Gary Carlson. I'm an attorney. I have a law firm here in Beaverton, Carlson Law Group, mm-hmm. in Cascade Plaza West building. And it's a general practice law firm. We help people get into a business. We take care of family law problems. We do trust, wills, and estate planning. If everything goes haywire, we can do bankruptcy. And we do personal injuries. And so it's overall a general practice law firm.
Okay.
I've done a lot of criminal law over the years, had 34 murder cases, 8 death penalty cases, so I've done a lot of that and other kinds of things when I was downtown Portland. And I moved from Portland, my office mm-hmm. from Portland, to Beaverton in 1999 because I live in Aloha.
Got it. And are you a longtime Oregonian?
From Montana originally, mm-hmm. and I've been around. I spent a year with the Montana Supreme Court after I'd graduated from the University of Montana Law School, and then I was an attorney with the National Labor Relations Board in Seattle for about 2.5 years. I then went with corporations, and I was labor relations manager for GTE, which is now Verizon. I went back to New York City at the corporate offices for 2.5 years. I learned I was a Westerner there. I learned that there's things I won't do for money, and one was to live back east. So I came back, and I was vice president of Rydell International, and that was involved in tugboats and dredges. It was also involved in building bridges and things like that.
Okay.
Built the east end of the Fairmont Bridge. And then I've been in practice since 1974 in private practice. During that time, I've also had some business experience because another person and I had a construction company down in Lebanon, and we built houses. And that was back in 1980 when the interest rates went way out of the sky,
right,
up to 18-20%. So at that time, we sold the lots we had and some homes that were in progress. And later I had a swimming pool hot tub company with another person that had retired from the Forest Service, ran that 3 years. He wanted to re-retire, so we sold that. So I've had those kind of experiences.
Quite a background, thank you. At the legislature, we have some funding issues that are going to be coming up because of the pension indebtedness. There's going to have to be some ideas floated around as to how to take care of the shortfall in revenue. What are your thoughts as to how this should occur?
Well, one of the reasons I decided to run for the state representative is I think it's an atmosphere creator. In other words, I wouldn't want to be a city councilman. They have to worry about the potholes and the lights and things like that. But at the state level, you can pass laws and try to make an atmosphere where people and businesses can prosper, thrive. Some of it's efficiency and how efficient you can make it. And as an attorney, I see an awful lot of laws that are very, very complicated. Mm-hmm. And so when they talk about funding it, I think there's two sides to the issue. You have to look at what you're doing and is it necessary to do that? And I think you can weed the garden, so to speak, in that area. And then you have to properly fund it. But you have to look at both sides. And I kind of believe that the government area of rules and regulations can be weeded down a little bit, and you can simplify things and make it less expensive.
Could you give me an example of how you could cut down on regulations?
Well, some just don't make sense. Mm-hmm. In other words, we suspend people's driver's license for not paying child support. Now, it's got a good purpose because mm-hmm. people say, everybody should pay child support. We got to figure a way to make these people pay that. But why would you take away a driver's license from somebody where you want them to make money so you can get the money to pay child support? There's also a law where you can suspend dentist's license, doctor's license, mm-hmm. and other kinds of license for not paying child support. Those kinds of things just don't make sense. You can get rid of them. Another area where we just make the laws more complicated. I've had a client, she was trying to get her driver's license and she'd been trying for 4 months. She had a birth certificate that was signed by this attending physician and the hospital administrator, but somehow in California it had never gotten certified. She'd gone to LA to try to get it and they said they can't find that it was ever filed, and in Sacramento, same thing. She had copies of her father and mother's certified mm-hmm. birth certificate, not hers. So I figured it'd be easy to get it. I tried the local level, the state level, couldn't get it done. Ultimately, I got a hold of one of the state legislators. I said, somebody's got to have some common sense. Can we do it? That was on a Wednesday. A call was made. On Thursday, I got a call, and she could pick up her license on the next day at the DMV. That shouldn't have to happen.
Good.
Need to simplify those things.
Okay. All right. One of the big issues before the legislature is, and a big chunk of the budget, is education.
Mm-hmm.
And right now we're putting a little more funding toward early childhood and toward higher ed. But K-12 is suffering. We have very high graduation rates and just a lot of issues with low test scores. So can you tell us how you, or what types of things would you support at the legislature?
Everybody wants very, very good education, and we want our students to be well equipped to go on and have successful lives. So that's uniform. Everybody wants that. I'm involved in the Beaverton Chamber and the Business Advisory Committee, the Westside Economic Alliance, and the Government Relations Committee, and many, many people, and they're all coming, and we need more money for education, and we need more money for the fire department, we need more money for the police department. They all need more money. So that's part of it. We have to properly fund them, but we also have to look at the other side about, can we do things more efficiently? And do we have things that are making it inefficient so we can do it within a lower amount of money? So I think that gets overlooked. I've gotten a lot of these questionnaires as a candidate to fill out,
mm-hmm.
and most of them are saying, will you support this? Will you support mm-hmm. this? And I'll support it, but let's look if there's a more efficient way to get things done. And I think we overlook that. Also, it gets difficult to get things passed. The caucus function. We get both sides,
mm-hmm.
you know, with their feet set and
firmly placed.
And if you're going to take 60 people and have a vote, you could probably resolve a lot of problems. But if you say this 30's got to agree, this 30's got to agree, we block it. So I want to kind of be an advocate or a squeaky vote for trying to figure out how to make government more efficient, more economical, and then properly fund it.
Okay. So you have two opponents in this race,
mm-hmm.
and this is an open seat right now because Tobias Reed has not running for re-election.
No, he's not the incumbent.
No.
Jeff Barker is
Jeff Barker is the incumbent.
He is the incumbent. He is running on the Democrat
side.
Mm-hmm.
I'm so sorry.
That's fine.
I goofed on that. What sets you apart from your opponents in the primary, and what qualities do you bring to the table?
Well, I know Jeff Barker is a retired highway patrolman.
Mm-hmm.
He has a focus on criminal laws particularly, mm-hmm. and that's primary. And that's important because we want criminal laws to be enforced. But even in criminal law areas, there's a lot of complexities that we put into it that make it very expensive and increases litigation rather than simplifying it. As far as my other opponents, I am an attorney, and I frequently say the nice thing about the legislature, when it used to have a lot of attorneys, they would argue and they could never agree on anything, so we didn't have so many laws passed. Now we've got people that are kind of involved in social work and things like that, and they think, I think that's a good law, and everybody's, me too, and you get another law. And then once you get a law, then you have the rules and regulations. But being an attorney and seeing that, I think has a certain advantage. And I've also had a much broader experience. I've worked in a service station for 11 years, starting when I was 11 to 22. I've fought forest fires in Montana, because that's where I'm from. I've had jobs in radio and television going mm-hmm. through law school. I worked in a mortuary. I drove an ambulance, and so I've had all that experience. I've been on the government side as an attorney for the National mm-hmm. Labor Relations Board. I've been in corporate law, so I understand that aspect of it. I've owned small businesses. I've had a construction company. So I can relate to an awful lot of people and their situation. And I want to try to help create an atmosphere where we can have rules and regulations, where businesses can thrive, individuals can thrive, schools can do better. I'd like to talk to teachers about, are there problems where you're being inhibited from being an effective teacher? And can we work on that as well as funding them?
Okay. Well, we've run out of time, but it's been wonderful to talk with you. Thank you so much for being here.
I've enjoyed it.
Thank you.